So hello, good afternoon. Anyone who decided to join us, meaning RF Elements and MS Distribution UK for this webinar today. I'm Tomáš Zvolenský, I'm with RF Elements, and we have Bushrod here with us from MS Distribution. So the number of the people who want to be connected to internet is constantly growing, and especially now, as you may have noticed or may have not noticed. But definitely the number of home workers is increasing. So the average speed of the internet connection requirement per user is also actually steadily growing over time as, of course, we use more and more bandwidth. And adding these two developments together, you get an exponential growth of the demand for throughput. And this is the kind of challenge the WISPs are perfectly geared and suited to solve. The number one challenge, though, the WISPs are facing today is that of the RF noise in the unlicensed bands, of course, most obviously. And the spectral graphs like these are very common. So high to very high noise floor that makes the 5 GHz wireless networks slow and unpredictable, making your life as a WISP gradually kind of like with diminishing amount of happiness, you know, in what you're doing. So you gradually find yourself giving up on the unlicensed spectra and maybe even actually on the business altogether, since the licensed links may be so much more expensive. And the main issue here are the antenna side lobes, which are almost never mentioned when talking about antennas, surprisingly. So high gain, yes, sure, everybody knows about that. The higher it is, the further I can shoot. Beamwidth, yes, of course, you want to know how wide of a sector you can get. Maybe front-to-back ratio, but not so much about the side lobes. So which are the main cause of the problems with noise in unlicensed WISP networks. And WISPs often do try to mitigate the noise of their networks using various shield kits. And if you must use an additional shielding for an antenna to work properly in the first place, then probably it's a good idea to look for a different antenna. And shield kits like these might improve the front-to-back ratio a little bit, which is great, right? No, actually, not really. Except the rare case of exactly back-to-back facing antennas. Front-to-back ratio is a useless parameter in terms of noise rejection, and the major side lobes are not affected by these shields. All that the shield does is that it rearranges the side lobes. So they point in different direction than without a shield, but they're not suppressed at all. As you can see from this comparison, so on the left, there is the near field radiation of a typical parabolic dish antenna without the shroud. You see a lot of happening there. So from right to left, there's the main beam, and then as you go off that direction, there is a lot of minor lobes, and those are the side lobes you know very well. While on the right side, you see the same exact antenna, but with the shield, which you can see, well, barely see here at the edge, yeah, as this horizontal line at the edge of the antenna. And yes, you can see comparing the backs of the antennas, like, okay, the front-to-back ratio improved, congrats on that. But the rest of the side lobes, as you can see, are still there. Sure, the directions are different, but hell, they're still there, and some are stronger, some are weaker. As I said, they're just rearranged. Nothing really happened to them. And over the years, the radio vendors have developed their hardware to improve the noise situation through GPS sync, for example, which ensures that the APs within your network transmit and receive at the same time to prevent the self-interference, which is also a huge part of the problem with the noise in general. Or, on the other hand, active filtering, which ensures your radio does not see out-of-channel signals. And these improvements are efficient, but also costly, and do not really deal with the root cause of the problems with interference, but with its consequences, which is a wrong approach, right? I mean, it's like trying to remove the smoke, but not doing anything with the fire that has caused it. Therefore, the first component on the way to increasing the throughput of a wireless network in unlicensed bands is to mitigate the noise. Our solution is different. Now, it deals directly with the source of the noise, not its symptoms. So prevention is much better than the cure. We all know that. And you don't want to just suppress the symptoms, but remove the root of the problems. And RF elements technology is the prevention. It provides efficient noise rejection and mitigation of loss within the radio system itself. And this is achieved through the horn sectors and twist-port ecosystem. So the horn sectors deal with the noise efficiently thanks to their zero side lobes radiation pattern. And twist-port, on the other hand, is an interface that introduces practically zero loss to the signal delivery from the radio to the antenna. The core issue of traditional patch array sectors are their frequency-dependent side lobes. So they have the side lobes because of the physics of patch array antennas. Simple as that. And these side lobes are an inherent property of the patch arrays as a type of antenna. So the side lobes you see on this radiation pattern, despite being substantially smaller than the main lobe, do decrease the SNR the radio is working with, which cripples overall network throughput and performance. RF element horns don't have any side lobes. Only one main lobe that covers the area you need without generating or receiving any noise through side lobes. Now, this effectively isolates your network from the surrounding noise, which is the essence of dealing with noise in unlicensed WIF networks. Getting rid of the side lobes equals getting rid of the noise. And all kinds of parabolic dish antennas used for a point-to-point or a CPE application also have significant side lobes, and thanks to which they cover vast areas beyond the main lobe, which is not desired. And this also makes them receive the noise from these areas through the side lobes. As a result of that is, you know, it's similar as with the patch array sectors. It's actually exactly the same. So poor and unstable network throughput. This is a radiation pattern of our ultra horn, a high gain and narrow beamwidth horn antenna. And also ultra horn has only one main lobe and nothing else. Suppressed noise and maximized throughput. So no side lobes equals no problem. Saying an antenna has or doesn't have side lobes is quite vague. And this is where beam efficiency comes to the rescue. It is a measurable variable that quantifies side lobes. In other words, it expresses the amount of side lobes an antenna has numerically. And because it is measurable, it's also does so reliably. So beam efficiency is the ratio of the energy in the main lobe to the total energy an antenna radiates. So the maximum beam efficiency you can achieve is 100%, in which case antenna has zero side lobes because 100% of the energy it radiates is in the main lobe. The closer to zero beam efficiency is, the more side lobes an antenna has, meaning more problems for your networks. Here is a radiation pattern of a generic parabolic dish. Its beam efficiency is 40%. This means that 40% of the power the antenna radiates goes into the main lobe. The remaining 60% is in the side lobes, because everything outside the main lobe is a side lobe. And front-to-back ratio, for example, only quantifies one side lobe precisely, yeah, and that's the back lobe. But beam efficiency is calculated from full 3D data of the radiation pattern, so making it the most complete measure of side lobes out there. It considers all the side lobes an antenna has. The comparison of antennas in terms of side lobe performance becomes extremely simple with beam efficiency. The higher it is, the better. That's it. An ultra horn on the left of the slide, you can see, has beam efficiency of 99%. It's only 1% of the power it radiates is in the side lobes. A generic dish, on the other hand, has beam efficiency of 40%. So the remaining 60% it radiates is in the side lobes. And clearly 99% is more than 40%. So ultra horn is way better antenna in terms of noise suppression. And to our knowledge, is the best antenna on the WISP market in terms of noise suppression. Vast majority of antennas used for sectorial coverage in WISP networks are either patch arrays or horns. And the patch arrays, due to the strong and frequency-dependent side lobes, have beam efficiency values of around 60%, depending on the manufacturer and the quality of a given design. The R. Hellman's horns, both symmetrical and asymmetrical, have beam efficiency between 90 and 95%. So you can see, actually, that there's also other horns in this graph, too. And this is to highlight the fact that having a horn antenna does not automatically mean its beam efficiency is high. And the stable and zero side lobe performance is not a given as soon as you have a horn. But we do put a lot of effort into optimizing our antennas, and the results are clearly showing. Similarly with the point-to-point antennas, the patch arrays are again at the bottom of the beam efficiency performance due to the demanding frequency-dependent side lobes collecting and transmitting the noise, hurting any and every WISP networks, really. Now, dishes are somewhat better, and generally the bigger the dish, the better the beam efficiency becomes, and that's if the antenna is carefully designed and also well manufactured at the same time. What is interesting here is the ultra horn with its 99% beam efficiency. So only 1% short of perfection. If you ever wondered if ultra horn was worth the extra cash compared to a dish of equivalent gain, you have a very clear answer here. With 99% beam efficiency, it will deliver high quality performance even in the worst noise conditions you can think of. Let's have a look at our twist board ecosystem, because delivering the maximum power from the radio to the antenna is, of course, also a part of being able to actually increase the throughput of your wireless networks. By removing the coaxial cables and connectors, you achieve zero loss system when delivering the signal to the antenna. And this is exactly what twist board does. Since the quality of the coaxial cables can vary widely, depending on from manufacturer to manufacturer, it can easily happen that you save as much as half of the radio power by using twist board ecosystem, which in turn helps you to reach those distant customers. And here is a loss comparison of typical values for coaxial cable and a waveguide the twist board is based on. The red line represents the coaxial cable and the black line the waveguide. So the x-axis shows us the frequency and the y-axis shows the loss in decibels per 100 feet. So while waveguide typically has 0.25 dB per 100 feet loss, coaxial cable has 100 times bigger loss. And this is what we mean by quote unquote, practically lossless. A waveguide the twist board is based on has 100 times smaller loss than a generic coaxial cable. The quality of antenna performance at both polarizations is also part of the overall throughput improvement. So let's see how. The traditional sector coverage is different when switching between the polarizations, which causes problems for the customers at the edges. Now, on top of that, because of the shape of the radiation pattern, the further away the customers are from the center of the sector, the worse their experience is. Where horn antennas, on the other hand, offer a uniform coverage in the whole sector and the same coverage area for both polarizations. So eventually every customer in the sector experiences the same high quality and stable service. Now, anytime you swap a traditional sector for horn, you see an increase in throughput, and it's the throughput you can rely on and the performance it provides. The trade-off between antenna gain and the SNR, or signal-to-noise ratio, is an important one to understand, especially for those who worry about the lower gain of horns compared to traditional sectors. With the patch array antenna sectors that are most common in the WISP industry, you get strong side lobes with the high gain they provide. And because of the ever-present noise, the performance you expect is diminished by as much depending on the height of the noise floor caused by the side lobes that decreases the SNR. And this is because, again, the physics of these antennas. With patch arrays, you're at the mercy of the side lobes, and no matter the gain of the main lobe and how high it is, you are depending on the surrounding noise conditions caused by either you through, you know, self-interference of your own sectors, or even worse, through the interference which is spread by your competitors in the same area. With horns, you can easily see huge throughput increase despite their smaller gain compared to the old sector they replace. How is that possible? Well, as is clear by now, the 5 GHz links suffer because of the background noise due to the side lobes of the antennas used. The traditional sectors have many side lobes. Now, if an antenna has no side lobes, which is the case with our horns, it doesn't collect the noise, which decreases the noise floor the radio is working with. And the radio cares mainly about the SNR, more than the signal strength alone, which is why an antenna with lower gain can provide better performance. The lack of side lobes lowers the noise floor, resulting into higher SNR, better MCS rates, and increased throughput as a result. So let's now have a look at a few scenarios on how you can actually go about, or how you can see the effect of the horns once you decide to swap those old sectors for horn sectors. With the traditional sectors, your network throughput is very sensitive to its surroundings. So whether you or your competitors add new sectors, your network always sees it through the side lobes as decreased and unstable throughput. And the horn antennas, on the other hand, only cover and receive the signal from where they're supposed to and nowhere else. Because of that, the sector is stable and performs at the limit of the maximum radio throughput. Now, when increasing the number of subscribers in a sector covered by a traditional patch array antenna, you experience a decline of the throughput with every new subscription. Because the sector is wide and the antenna has strong side lobes, the collocation of multiple sectors is very difficult. With horns, you can divide the sectors into smaller or wider portions. And because of the lack of the side lobes, each of the collocated sectors performs with zero self-interference, superb stability and throughput, which results into happy customer base and actually a headache-free network for you as the owner of the business. So in a nutshell, dividing a wide and very sensitive sector into more compact units using horns with no side lobes, you can collocate as many sectors as you wish, while at the same time, you can be sure that each of the sectors works at its best, leveraging the maximum throughput the radios enable. The patchery sectors with their light side lobes always see the closely located sectors, resulting into you not being able to use the neighboring channels to leverage the full spectrum your radio supports. And due to the lack of side lobes, the horns do not see the neighboring sectors, which gives you the ability to fully reuse the previously noisy and unusable channels. Even in the case the neighboring sectors point away from yours, the side lobes are still strong enough to increase the noise floor your radio sees, which is resulting into lower throughput you can achieve. Yeah, and horns can help here as well. I mean, not seeing the neighboring sectors, the noise floor is pushed down, the SNR is improved, and you can leverage those higher modulation rates up to the capabilities of the radios you use. While the traditional sectors, with them you don't have a lot of options in terms of the beam width, and the side lobes make addition of every new sector almost a cringing experience, because the network performance will gradually decrease with every additional sector. The superb collocation and lack of side lobes of horns, though, makes the growth of your network easy and pain-free. So you can grow the size of your network virtually indefinitely. And this is the core of scalability and the ability to grow your network throughput. Get the noise under control with horns, and adding new sectors becomes an extremely simple task. And here you see a few examples of how many horn sectors you can put on a single tower. Looks kind of almost unbelievable, doesn't it? With horns, though, this is daily reality. Once you control the amount of noise, everything else falls in place. And these are the pictures actually provided by our customers. They're not staged. They're real pictures. Our customers, I think these are from the United States, have provided us. So the RF elements technology is the winning formula for unlicensed WISP networks. The lack of side lobes of horns ensures really great noise immunity. And the lack of coaxial cables and interconnects ensures delivery of maximum power to the antenna. And the toolset of 11 different horn antennas with various beam widths and gains enable incredible scalability. So now you have 11 different tools that you can really use to optimize the coverage of your network as you please. So you, on the other hand, have the spare time to focus on the growth of your company instead of having to run around and keep servicing the underperforming links and you know, taking the calls from complaining customers all the time. And all these benefits come at no added cost, really. You can easily do without GPS sync if the antennas do not see each other like horns. And due to noise suppression, you do not need to use the wide channels either. or spend additional money for non-effective fixes. Horns are a complete solution in and of itself. So this concludes the main amount, the main topic of this presentation. And here I would just highlight a few things that people are actually asking most often. And one of these questions is where to buy our products. And on our webpage, there is a stock locator where, you know, selecting the product you want to buy and your geographical region, you can, you know, it will give you the list of distributors that are nearest to you. Another common question is, how far can I go with these horns you're talking about? And the answer is deserves a lot more than just this simple question, because there's a lot more that comes into the equation and, you know, to be able to answer this question, and which is why we have our link calculator. So again, on our webpage, rfelements.com, you see that tab on the right side, circled in green, is the shortcut to the link calculator, where you can set up all the parameters of your link, including the CPE device, the output power of the AP radio. Obviously, choose any of our antennas, and there you go. You'll see the result, for example, such as the one you see in the slide, yeah, where you basically see where in what area you can achieve what MCS level, which is really a great tool and actually really answers, provides the most accurate answer to the question of how far our antennas go. Sometimes people contact us with the wish to become a distributor of our products. And again, starting on our landing page, sliding all the way down and clicking on the Become a Distributor link, you'll be brought to this questionnaire, where you fill all the details of your company, and once you send it away, we will, you know, review your data and contact you with the next steps as soon as possible. And we also have rfelab.com, which is our user forum, where I encourage you to register, and we announce all kinds of events we're taking part in, except obviously now in the times of the virus when everyone is at home. Nevertheless, there's also a lot of questions that our users asked and we answered. So it's a really great knowledge resource to search through. Or if you have a question that is not answered there, you of course can ask your own. And it is really the fastest way to get to the answer. Yeah, because we check the forum daily, and once you ask a question there, you can be sure that one of the people from RF Elements is actually answering it. On our YouTube channel, we have a playlist called Wisp Traveler, where you can see short videos where we interview Wisps like yourselves about how they, you know, benefited from using our antennas. And we have customers all around the world, so, you know, whichever is closest, whichever part of the world is closest to your heart, you can check the video from that area. Another channel we have on YouTube is called Inside Wireless, and these are even shorter videos which are supposed to shed light on the most common concepts of the RF engineering world, obviously, which are connected to running a WISP network. Yeah, everything about antennas, modulations, noise floor, beamwidths, all of that. So regardless if you're an experienced WISP, a veteran RF engineer, or just starting in this business, it is a great resource to either refresh your knowledge or learn something new. Right. So that concludes the webinar. And yeah, looking forward to any following webinars. All right. Have a nice day.